When it comes to iconic hats, nothing says French more than the beret. Specifically, the Basque-style beret, as they wear different styles in other countries. The Basque beret was traditionally worn by shepherds tending their flocks along the Pyrenees mountain range that divides France from Spain. The Basque beret dates back to the 1600s in southern France. Made of black merino wool, it has a little cabillou on top. The factory making these berets has been doing so since 1840. An automated machine knits undyed wool yarn into a galette, the French for pancake. The galette is flat and round, with loose-knit stitches, making it soft and floppy. The machine then closes the galette with a single thread. Here it is being pulled out to show you the thread that's used. The rudimentary beret is then washed in soap and lukewarm water from the local river for about 8 hours. The type of soap used is a trade secret. The wool shrinks, causing the loose-knit stitches to tighten. Also, the wool fibers soften, transforming them into felt. The next stage is the dyeing process. First, the beret is loaded into another washing machine, but this time with a powdered dye. The factory has always produced its own dyes in a range of colours. Again, water from the local river is used during this process, but the temperature it's heated to is a closely guarded secret. Once the dye cycle is finished, the beret is checked against a colour sample. This is because the wool composition and the river water quality are variables which can affect dye absorption. The next step is to form the beret's final shape. In the past, beret factories did this using wooden forms, but today they're metal. The beret stays on the form until the shape is locked in. How long depends on the wool composition, as well as how humid it is in the factory on that day. Each beret is then placed on a scratching machine. The surface of these rotating drums is lined with wire brushes, whose bristles lift the wool fibers, thickening the felt. Next, after inserting a cardboard template to maintain the shape, a razor is used around the area known as the cabillou. Then any plant debris left by the river water used during the wash and dye cycles is removed. After which, the hat is inspected for any holes or stretched fibers. The beret now goes to the seamstress. First, a black cotton lining is heated in a mold. This is to shape it to fit perfectly inside the beret. The lining has the manufacturer's label in the center, which features the company crest and the model name. To sew in the lining, the beret is turned inside out. After which, the beret is turned the right way round and put on a stretching machine. The machine is set to the required hat size and it automatically stretches the beret to that size. A black leather band is then sewn around the edge. Each band has its hat size printed on it to ensure the correct one is fitted. An information tag is then attached. Among other details, it tells the customer that the hat is made of 100% pure virgin wool, its model number, color, and care instructions. Don't wash, dry clean, or iron. The final touch is the company's metal hallmark, which is riveted in place. That, chers amis, caps off production. C'est bon. Bleu. Rouge. Pastis is an anise-flavoured liqueur popular in France, particularly in the southern city of Marseille, where it originated. The traditional method of drinking pastis is to dilute it with water. It was originally distilled as a replacement for another popular drink in France, absinthe, that was banned in 1915. The maker of this pastis combines star anise with licorice extract and herbs and spices from the Provence region of France. Star anise is an Asian spice, and the starting ingredient for this pastis is pale yellow star anise essential oil. The first step at this distillery is to distill that essential oil. As it's heated, it evaporates and rises up the column of a still, passing through a series of stacked cooling trays. Each tray condenses, then removes one of the oil's various components. Pastis requires just one of the extracted components, anethol, an organic compound responsible for the anise flavor and smell. This recipe contains 60 different herbs and spices, each of which is separately distilled into alcohol. One such herb is Artemisia vulgaris, commonly known as mugwort. Its leaves are first loaded into a tank filled with a mixture of water and alcohol. As the leaves soak, the alcohol acts as a solvent, extracting the aromatic molecules in a process called maceration. After a few days, the alcoholic liquid is drained, which is now infused with aromatic molecules. It's so alcoholic that it emits volatile fumes, so the workers wear an alarm that sounds when the surrounding atmosphere reaches an explosive level. The liquid is stored in a vat until it's time to mix the pastis, while the alcohol-soaked mugwort leaves are transferred into a distillation apparatus called an alembic. The alembic heats the mash of fermented leaves with steam produced by a wood-fired boiler. Once the mash heats to a temperature of 78.3 degrees Celsius, the alcohol begins to evaporate and rise. The alcoholic vapor eventually reaches the neck of the alembic, where cooling coils condense it back into a liquid. This then flows out of the alembic through a filter that removes plant particles. An alcoholometer measures the percentage of alcohol in the fluid, which starts off very high, then tapers off. Only the middle of the flow is used when the reading is between 70 and 50%, what's known as the heart of the distillation. It's now time to make the pastis by combining all the ingredients. The anethol distilled from the anise essential oil, the 60 different maceration liquids and distillates of herbs and spices, and the licorice extract. Water is also added to dilute the final product's alcohol level to 45%. A last filtration removes any particles that would otherwise diminish the clarity of the pastis. The final product is bottled in dark glass to protect the contents from light that by oxidization would damage the liqueur. The second station on the filling line seals the bottle with a T-cork, a type of stopper designed for bottles which are opened and sealed repeatedly. A sheath of heat-shrink plastic is then placed over the T-cork. The bottle then travels through a heating tunnel, which shrinks the plastic tightly over the neck of the bottle. Finally, a label is applied to the bottle and the pastis is ready to be dispatched. Garçon, glaçon, in mi glace, s'il vous plaît. Merci.